Hi, I'm Mary Poplin with Boris FX, and today I'd like to show you a little bit about PowerMesh, and specifically, how to get into the nitty-gritty of PowerMesh. In this tutorial, I'm going to show you how to put a mask onto a person's face. And to do that, we're going to go over some pretty complex techniques, including editing your vertices or getting rid of vertices. All right, to get started, let's talk a little bit about how you need to set up your shot. To set up your shot, one of the things I want you to notice is that this clip is longer than our comp, and it's longer in both the head and the tail, okay? When you set up shots with Mocha, we're gonna assume that you've got your shot set up like a visual effects shot, which means to say it is a trimmed shot. And for whatever your workflow is, that might not be a practical setup. So in order to just trim this out, what you can do is you can go to Layer, Pre-compose, and you can make sure that you move all of the attributes into the new composition. And this is really important. Adjust composition duration to the time span of your selected layers. And so this is going to be our track layer. All right, now if we put a mask onto this guy, we also want to make sure that this matches the entire clip. So if this went off screen in either direction or was animated, we would do the same thing. We would go to Layer, Pre-compose, move all attributes into the new composition, and adjust the composition duration. We call this Mask Insert. We hit OK. So now we have our mask and our original clip. And we know that our mask is the exact same size as our original comp. And it's the same frame rate, frame length, and it starts on the same frame. So now I know that if I drag and drop Mocha onto my layer, or if I go to Effect, Boris FX Mocha, and select Mocha Pro, that I'm applying my Mocha plugin to the exact same length shot. Now when I launch Mocha, you're going to see that my shot is trimmed properly. So now I have to think about how to break down this shot for tracking. Well, when I play this, I can see that I have the two fingers that he's holding up go over his face. Now I want to make sure that I hold those fingers out. So now I could either take the magnetic spline tool or the X-spline tool and draw a shape right around these fingers. In this case, I'm just going to use the X-spline really quick because this is a really fuzzy edge and something like the magnetic spline tool might not be the best tool for this. We're going to select all our points and relax for a curve. I'm going to call this fingers roto. And we're going to track this using translation, scale, rotation, and shear. I could use mesh warp to track this, but it's not really necessary for something so stiff and blurry. All right, so let's show you an After Effects trick. Now that I have my fingers rotoed, I can make some keyframes. So I'm going to make a keyframe here because this still looks pretty good. And I'm going to make a keyframe here, here, and then I'm going to just drag this right off screen. Because in After Effects, you actually want your roto to pop on and off. If you don't, you'll have to trim your layer inside of After Effects, and that can get kind of annoying and hard to keep track of. So for sanity's sake, I like to keep my roto popped off screen when I don't need it anymore. This also means that you don't have to trim shapes when you need to have them further down the line. So a lot of times the question we get is, well, can I trim my layer in more than one place? And the answer is no, but you can always animate your shape on and off screen over and over and over again. Solves that problem. I don't need this anymore, so off screen it goes. And we'll just correct this. All right, now that finger roto looks pretty good, but we're gonna need to use this as a holdout mat. So I'm going to duplicate this. I'm going to lock my finger roto and hide it, and I'm going to call this fingers holdout. And I want to keep my fingers roto line really close to the edge because I'm going to use that as a mat in my final comp. But in order to hold out the shape from my power mesh track that I'm going to create, I actually want this to be much bigger. So we're going to use our Uber key and we're going to just scale this out a little bit. And we're going to use the lasso selection tool and we're going to select these edge points and we're just going to move them over here, just like this. And so now what we end up with is a much wider shape. And because we used the Uber key, which is right here again, it's a ripple edit across my entire shape. So now I know that all of that data will be held out from my mask track. This is important because the power mesh track is actually really sensitive. So now I'm going to make a new shape for my power mesh. And I'm just going to go ahead and start tracking actually here at the beginning of our shot. And we're going to draw a shape right around this guy's face, just like this. Now, the reason I'm going overboard on my shape size is because I want to generate a much bigger mesh than I actually need. So we're going to go over to our track section. We're going to track translation, scale, rotation, shear, perspective, and mesh. All right. And you see how that automatically generates a mesh? We're going to go to uniform and generate our mesh. And that's going to be our mesh warp generation for our face. Now, I don't want to track every single one of those points because power mesh is really sensitive. So I want to make sure that I'm only tracking an area that power mesh is going to play nice with. So if we turn our mats on, you can see we don't want that area to be, we don't want that area to be this whole face. So we're going to just scale this in to the inside edges of the face. Now with regular planar tracking, a lot of times what you want to do is you want to make sure that you go outside the edges of the object. Well, because we're breaking this down into subplanar tracks, we actually don't want to do this. We don't want to track the edges. And that's because power mesh is really sensitive, like I said. And because power mesh is so sensitive, it will grab data we don't want it to, like these back bricks or the bottom of his neck or his eyes. So we're going to switch back to auto key and I'm going to just keyframe this in. There we go. And once I'm satisfied with the shape, I can actually hit track forwards. So we're going to call this face track. And most importantly, we're going to take face track and we're going to hide it underneath our fingers holdout. Here's why. Look how these fingers hold out of this mesh shape. That's going to be important. We're going to turn off our gear for our fingers holdout track because we don't need to track that anymore. And we're going to hit face track forwards. I'm going to leave the mat on so you can see what the mat is doing as the fingers move over the top. I left smoothness at 50 because that's a pretty good choice for a face. And we're going to see what results we get. I want you to notice some of the weird stretching that happened over the mouth, and we're going to correct that. Let's click our Edit Mesh button. And again, make sure that we're using Lasso Selection. I'm going to grab some of these points. And then back here at the very beginning of my shot, I'm going to make sure that I just keyframe them. And I feel like here is about the last nice frame that we see of them. And then we start getting it smashed. And technically that's correct because that's what his lip is doing. But it's not going to look good in the warp. So we want to sort of fake it a little bit. And especially there, it doesn't look good. So let's just even this out. And I want you to see how this animation is a lot like a just track. So if you've used a just track before in Mocha, you know that you can hand animate over the track. And we want it to scrunch by the lip, we do. But what we don't want it to do is we don't want it to scrunch in a weird sort of way. Now, I feel like this keyframe probably needs to be taken out and readjusted. There we go. All right, so we hand adjusted that. So let's see how that ends up looking. Let's go to our stabilize module and let's add frame one to our frame list, or rather our frame at this time code. We know that we aligned our mask on this frame. So we know that back in After Effects, if we apply this data to the first frame, the mask will move along from there. We're going to use a mesh warp, unwarp, high quality, save, and close, just like the rest of our applications of PowerMesh. We're going to copy this, and we're going to paste it right back on to our mask layer. On our mask layer, we're going to twirl down module renders, check render, stabilize warp, and hit play. Let's see how that looks. That looks pretty good. It's a little stretchy, but we can probably get away with it. Let's talk about another way to troubleshoot that problem area on the mouth. Another way I can troubleshoot that problem area I can select my mesh editing tool, and again, make sure I'm on lasso selection, and I can just draw a big shape right around these points and delete them. And now the rest of my mesh is going to drive that warp. But I actually think that it looks better with the hand-animated adjustments on the mesh warp in order to achieve a more realistic warping result. Now we can finish the shot in a couple of ways. I can duplicate my background layer. I can call this fingers. Under my module renders, I can make sure I'm not rendering anything. And under matte, I can go to apply matte, visible layers. And we're just going to use fingers roto. So now my fingers are cut out over the top. And I can feather this right in my plugin. Another thing I can do is I can launch Mocha. And I can add motion blur to my fingers layer just by clicking this button, saving, and closing. But there's not a lot of depth to that mask, so let's find some edge light. We're going to use BCC edge lighting to add a little bit of bevel and emboss to this mask. We're going to use some top-down edge lighting. And our highlights and shadows, we're going to do a lot of blur, like 100 pixels of blur. Same thing for the shadow. Now we have a really soft and subtle edge lighting. The last thing we're going to want to do is we're going to want to apply a motion blur to the mask. So we need to add motion blur to make this look realistic. We're going to go to layer and we're going to pre-compose this to lock Mocha and our edge lighting right inside of this mask. We're going to call this add moblur mask. And again, we're going to move all of our attributes into the new composition. We don't need to trim it anymore, so we can leave that checked off, and we hit OK. And now we can try to use something like BCC motion blur or CC force motion blur, but I found that that doesn't always play nice with plugins. So we're going to just use a pixel motion blur and drag and drop this right onto our mask. You can add the motion blur of your choice. I find that using the pixel motion blur might be your best call. Or CC force motion blur if you want to keep it native. You can use BCC motion blur if you use a pre-comp and make sure that it's enveloped. Or you can use something like real smart motion blur as well. If you wanted to be a perfectionist, you could go in and rotoscope some ear elastic. But I intentionally had this stick a little bit off his face so that we could hide it and not have to rotoscope that. This also works really well for cloth masks. And obviously, the more vertical your crease is, the more it's going to sell it. And the more horizontal your crease is, well, you know, depending on mouth motion, the less it might sell it. As usual, shot planning is key. I hope those tips were helpful. If you have any questions, please find us at www.borisfx.com, where you can find all sorts of training videos, user forums, support, and so much more.